Woman tears down our fence for satellite TV, and 10 years later, the police chief is fired as a direct result. July of 2002, when I was 16, our neighbor, who was a brat with a capital C, decided she wanted to have satellite TV installed. The house she lived in had a very small yard in back, smaller in front, and the fence that my mother had installed a couple of years ago was only about 5 yards from her side door. The only place her satellite could be installed was on the back of the house, but there was no way the vehicles could make it to her backyard, so in her infinite wisdom, Brat decided to have them tear down our fence and drive over our property to get to her backyard. This starts a huge fight between her and my mother. Brat decides to claim that Mom built the fence too close to her house anyway, and my mom produced the land description to prove that the fence was in the right spot. Turns out they were both wrong. We knew the woman had built her house too close to the property line, but it seems it was closer than we thought. She was only feet from the line. That fence should have been almost touching the side of her house. Her uncle was the deputy mayor of our small 2,000 population town, and she tried to get him involved. Nothing came of it, so we thought it was over. Late September, early October that same year, while I was in school, Mom was taking a shower when our two dogs alerted her to someone at our door. She put on a bathrobe and went to see the police chief and about a dozen officers on our lawn, claiming that they had been tipped off to a meth lab on the property, and demanded to be allowed to search. Mom realized that the brat had to have been the one to call them, as the chief of police was known to be a personal friend of her family. Mom demanded a search warrant, and they didn't have one, which triggered several hours of them refusing to leave until they searched the property. This all started around 9 or 10 in the morning. Nearing 3 p.m., Mom tells them that she needs to pick me up from school and take me to her mother's house because I couldn't drive yet. They refuse to move their vehicles to let her leave and say it's fine, they'll send a squad car to pick me up, which just would have humiliated me. Mom calls her lawyer, who informs her that if they don't produce a warrant, to tell them to leave. So the chief tells her if he goes for a warrant, he'll tell whoever issues them that he can smell meth on the property and will be given a warrant for anything he asks for. He will then return, kick our door out of the frame, and if our dogs even look at him for that, he'll shoot both of them in the head and kill them both. Yes, he actually said that to my mother. Mom called Grandma to pick me up from school nearly an hour after it let out and let the police search the house. They find my mom's gun safe. This safe was one of those made with steel with a circular lock, kind of like on a soda machine, they had a key sitting on top of it. Before anyone says how unsafe it was just my mom and my stepdad in the house most of the time. I was an only child and lived with my grandparents, and only visited on weekends, and Mom kept the door to her room locked with a key. There was no way anyone under 18 was getting near her guns. The cops proceeded to take a crowbar and pry the safe open, even though the key was right there, and it's clearly the key to the safe. They then take the guns outside and divide them up. They even take my mom's handgun, which she had a concealed carry permit for. This continued for hours until my mom relented and opened up my stepdad's shop building. He was using it to house his motorcycle, which he slowly restored from a wreck about 15 years before. They barely got over the threshold of the door before screaming, "Meth lab!" and pointing at the cleaning agents and bottles that were scooted together. Nothing else. No signs of meth other than some cleaning agents and empty mason jars sitting near one another. They brought out heavy spot lamps and more cops. By 1 in the morning, my mother had been sitting outside in the cool fall weather in nothing but a bathrobe this entire time. They claimed to have found a marijuana plant behind our 6-foot-tall privacy fence that kept people from seeing us in our hot tub. When I found out about this, I was upset. I was 16 and went to school in a small town. Everyone would know about it. The next day, Saturday, I was piddling around on the internet when a friend messaged me to ask what had happened and why was my mother in jail. My mother was not in jail. The friend says, "My mom said it's on the news right now. Mom and stepdad last name are sitting in jail this weekend without bond for running the largest drug den in your town's history." When Mom called the news to ask them why they'd ran that story without checking, they apologized and said they'd been contacted by town police and were told to run the story. The next night, they issued a public apology for it. I refused to go to school that Monday. It is very important to note that I had not been in school since Friday. On Tuesday, when my grandpa dropped me off, the drug-sniffing dog was at the school. However, as it was close to drug-free week, I thought nothing of it. My business teacher told me she'd seen the article in the local paper, but it looked like it had been staged, and that if I caught any crap for it, to let her know. I went to my locker as the officer walked out of the same hallway, but since that was the hall the principal's office was on, I didn't think anything of it. I noticed a locker standing completely open, and when I got to it, I realized it was my locker. I blew up on the principal. I understand now that it's not my property and the school can authorize it being searched, but that was just bullcrap. Why was I being searched? "No, you weren't searched. You must have left your locker open last night." Friend 1 and Friend 2 have their lockers next to mine, and they have basketball practice until 4. They shut my locker if I leave it open. I haven't been here since Friday. Are you telling me that everyone in this school left a locker standing open for all of Monday? I called my mom and was pulled out of school for Tuesday as well. Ultimately, all charges were thrown out because of that marijuana plant. The chief of police put in his official report that it had been 8 feet tall, and when questioned about it when they tried to press drug charges on Mom, he clearly said, "Yes, Your Honor, it was 8 feet tall." The judge asked him when he found it, and he said about 1 in the morning. The judge then said if there had really been a marijuana plant that was 8 feet tall behind a 6-foot fence, he would not have had to needed to demand permission to search the property. The charges were thrown out. That's where it stood for 10 years. Mom waited and played the long game because she wanted to make fully sure the statute of limitations ran out. She didn't want to give him any legal reason to retaliate against her. She waited and waited. Then, on the first town council meeting after the statute ran out, she made contact with one of the council members. In a small town, you don't frick with the council members. Everyone knows them, and everyone listens to them. Or they do here, at least. This was the head of the council, too. And the time his grandson was my co-worker, so he kind of knew me, and he liked me well enough since I worked for the largest business in our area. He listened to Mom's story and told her that the last he'd heard, there was nothing in the evidence locker at the station at the moment, meaning none of the guns they'd confiscated had been entered. When she told him most of them belonged to me and were basically my family heirlooms, they were, he nodded and asked her that if he could produce those guns, could she prove they belonged to us? Mom said she had a notebook of descriptions of the guns, their serial numbers on the hunting rifles that had scopes, and that two of them had distinguishing marks that were hidden from sight, but she could find them and show them off. Because my mom loves having a paper trail on everything. He told her he would get them back that Monday. We found out that he went to the station and told the same police chief that because they had never successfully charged us with any crime, and that now that the statute of limitations had run out, all the confiscated property had to be turned back over to us, but there was rumor that the guns weren't in evidence. He would be in on Monday to have it checked. The police chief went pale, and on Monday, they were all in the evidence locker. However, one of them was missing a scope. It came out somehow that the chief of police had never intended to enter them into evidence and had sold them to his friends. He'd been thinking he got away with it for a decade until Mom turned back up with the proof that they all belonged to her and legally now had to be returned. He had to go and buy back every one of them, sometimes paying more than twice what he'd been paid because some of those friends had not been speaking to him for some time, and one of them had taken the scope off a while back. He was immediately fired and arrested for it. We got our guns back. I'm not paying a finder's fee for stolen property. Thief earns himself a felony instead. I had just moved to a new city for work and had been working here for about 3 months, so I'm still pretty new to the area. My apartment complex, I would say, is in a nicer part of the city, and it's been pretty well kept, so I didn't really expect anyone to go try breaking into cars. I was set to travel and had a pretty early drive, so I packed everything for my week-long trip the night before so that I could get up and just get on the road. The next morning, I walk out to my car and I see clothes off to the side of my car and, thinking it was weird, started to look around the car. Turns out, my car had been broken into and was cleaned out. Out of the trunk, they took my laptop bag, which had both my personal computer and a government computer, 2 gym bags, one that had my work clothes and the other had my workout clothes and personal hygiene stuff, and a backpack that had my Nintendo Switch and office supplies in it. They also took $50 out of the console where I keep change and random bills for parking. This obviously throws a wrench into my work travel, so I call my supervisor and explain the situation and come back into work. It's my fault that I left all the stuff in the car, so I had to go to our security/IT office and explain what had happened, and see what the next steps were to get a new work computer. During this meeting with the physical security manager, which was 3 hours after I found my car broken into, I get a call from a local number, and it turns out this guy had found my laptops on the side of the road when he was coming home from visiting his mom. My bag had a contact me I found and my number. The conversation goes as follows. Hey man, I found your laptops on the side of the road. I figured you'd want them back. They look pretty important. Government laptops are plastered with stickers with official jargon and returning instructions. For sure. I'm currently at work right now, but I can come meet you or whatever works. Yeah man, I'm just coming back from visiting my mom, so I'm trying to get home so I can relax. Cool, I can make it work. Can you text me your address and everything so I can just come to you? I'll send it to you here in a second. It's also my birthday, so if I could get some money for like a finder's fee or whatever, I think that would be cool. Yeah man, whatever you need, see you in a bit. As soon as I get off the phone, I call the local police in that area and explain that this guy is trying to extort money from me to get stolen goods back. They instruct me to meet him a few blocks away from the residence and they will send a plainclothes cop and officers to act on my behalf, so I'm not in direct contact with the guy, just in case the situation sounds sketchy. I go meet them where they go into the residence. The guy is hesitant seeing the cop cars and takes a few minutes to return the bag with the laptops in it. They bring the bag to me to identify the laptops and everything's still there. I accept the bag and got my laptops and bag back. Easy enough. On the drive back to work, no more than 15 minutes later, this guy still had my number and it starts going off. Bad unreadable spelling and all is seething through text messages on how could I get the police involved. He was trying to be a good Samaritan and he should have thrown my crap in the garbage. Oh, he's spelling garbage wrong. And he should have thrown my crap in the grabbing. So I did the normal thing and blocked the number. Now, I'm still missing everything else, including the Nintendo Switch, which was in a case with 7 games. Important. I was originally going to take the loss on it and take it as a stupidity tax, since it was almost impossible to get back. However, something didn't sit right with me with this guy, and thinking if he did have it, he was going to try to sell it fast and cheap. I went onto a local Facebook market page and Craigslist looking for a Switch for cheap around the same location as his house. Bingo! The ad read, $200, Nintendo Switch with 7 games in case, lightly used, no charger or dock, must be gone today. The location was enabled and within 2 miles of his address. The phone number was the same, and the dock and charger were in my apartment. So I had a buddy of mine who lived in the next city over contact him, asking if he could hold on to it till tomorrow, since he wouldn't be in town until the next day and would pay him $300 instead. The dude agrees and also gets him to read off all 7 games that were there. This was to buy more time so I could coordinate with the police. The next morning, I get everything together to go make a case to the police to assist me on this. Police report, the Craigslist ad, the serial number from Nintendo, the screenshots of the text messages between him and my buddy. I make my case and the police agree to do the same thing as the day before and meet me somewhere else to go over what the plan was. I meet them and go over his address and what all I had missing. These are different officers than the day before and they recognize the address and his name. We find out this guy is known for this stuff and is currently on probation. So we come up with a plan where my buddy will call us on his work phone so we can hear the conversation and call him on his regular phone to see what's going on. The police use a plain car, go to this meetup spot, and acting like my buddy, scoop the guy up and get him to cough up the rest of the stolen goods. They were able to recover all of my items, including all of my clothes and bags. He ends up going to jail and earns a new felony on his record for receiving stolen property. I think I would have lost the rest if I didn't do the digging on Facebook Marketplace and Craigslist. Demand proof of illness? I hope you have eye bleach. I had a boss one time who was such a control freak that she demanded to know specifically why I was calling out sick, wildly illegal where I live, one day. And for reference, I'm typically the guy who never gets sick, so it wasn't an attendance issue. I told her I think I had food poisoning. It turned out to be true and actually wrote a ULPT based off of this story a while back. And she kept pressing me as to explain what my symptoms were and why I couldn't make it in, all via text. I finally had enough and was like, look, I'm not physically capable of working today and you're not allowed to ask me personal questions about illness and medical history. She threatened me with a write-up if I couldn't specifically explain slash prove why I couldn't make it into work. This is where the pro-revenge comes in. I was about to send her something horrific that she could not unsee, and she wouldn't be able to do jack about it since she technically asked for it. Being that I was living in the bathroom for more than 2 days, this inquiry was on day one. And had aggressive diarrhea every 15 to 30 minutes, and the worst abdominal pain I've ever experienced. I lost my crap, har har. I took a pretty disturbing picture of me painting the bowl brown right before I flushed, and sent it to her. No joke, it looked like I power washed the inside of the toilet with feces and built a turd island in the middle of the water. It honestly looked like a poop volcano had erupted. I had no idea your bowels could contain so much. My text to her read, "This is happening every 15 to 30 minutes and I haven't been able to leave the bathroom for the past 6 hours. Here's your proof. Check the timestamp." Also sent a screen of the timestamp. "I'll let you know as soon as I can if I'll be in tomorrow." So after 3 days off, I show up for my shift, sleep deprived and sore from sleeping in my bathtub or on the floor for 2.5 days. Butthole not having any of it, but I was finally through the worst. She immediately escorts me into her office where our regional HR rep is waiting for me and we all sit down. He has paperwork in front of him and is discussing the incident with me and gets me to acknowledge what I did, and that sending unprovoked and offensive content to coworkers constitutes harassment and blah blah blah, right before he asks me to sign a final write-up. If you do something like this again, you're fired. Before signing, I asked him, "Did she tell you why I sent this?" He was dumbfounded and said, "This really isn't excusable," and basically handed me a screenshot printout of the text messages where this bench deleted everything in the exchange, in her phone, but me saying, "Sorry, I need to take a sick day today," and the picture. I laughed and handed him my phone and said, "Here's the full exchange." He asked me to leave and give them a few minutes. About 10 minutes later, he calls me in by myself and explained what I already knew, that she was the harasser and that she had aggressively violated privacy laws and would be dealt with, and to call him if anything like this ever happens again. I found out from one of the assistant managers that she ended up getting a final written notice and was super close to being fired, and it prevented her from getting a big promotion that she was being looked at for. So, if you ever come across a dickhead boss who wants to play doctor and question your sick leave, send them diarrhea pics and they'll either STF you or give you lawsuit material. Sometimes the customer is wrong for unrelated reasons. Due to the well of my friend's definitely not an axe murderer date recommendations drying up, I have turned to that most sacred of modern relationship institutions, online dating. As a very busy person trying to get in with other very busy people, I prize honesty and directness above all else when it comes to profile creation. I include full body shots in my photos, try to minimize the use of MySpace angles and selfies, and write at the very top of the summary/caption/profile that I am fat. Not curvy, not thick, not lots to love, I'm freaking fat. I'm not ashamed of it, but I also know that weight is a deal breaker for lots of people. I don't want to waste anyone's time. About a year ago, I met Evan via Tinder. We exchanged friendly messages for a few hours one night and agreed to meet up for drinks the following evening. I waited for a full hour past the designated time, and just as I was getting up to leave, the text started rolling in. "I can see you sweating from here. How long does it take you to roll out of bed every morning? Is there an earthquake or are you just getting up for more pretzels?" Really idiotic, juvenile crap. Four separate numbers commenting on things like my clothes, which clued me in that the senders were nearby. This went on for 15 minutes before I finally saw Evan trying to hide in a corner table and giggling with a group of buddies. I made eye contact, saw that he saw me, and walked out. The text kept up until I blocked the numbers a few hours later. I ran into Evan about 3 weeks later. We got on the same elevator, and he tried really hard at being super interested in the emergency phone instructions. I just confronted him, and he admitted it was just the game that he and his friends play. He knew I was fat before agreeing to meet up. They all did. Because that's what they do. Match up with fat women and then either ghost them or troll them at the meetup. It was also kind of obvious that he'd never seen any consequences from this bull, as he was sweating pretty hard and looked more humiliated than I felt. I just said whatever and walked out, expecting to never see him again. About a month ago, some local foodie wrote a great review of the restaurant I own, and we've been slammed ever since. In the past, I stayed mostly in the kitchen, but I've been doing more and more front of house stuff lately. And Valentine's Day, I was working with a bit of a split between the two. I saw Evan just as he was pushing in his date's chair. My name isn't on the restaurant, and he didn't see me. I checked the section up at the hostess stand and saw that one of my favorite old timers, Nan, was going to be his waitress. I went to the bar till, took out $400, put it in her hands, and said, "This is going to be your only table for the rest of the night. You are going to make this the worst date he's ever been on." She spilled every single thing she brought out to the table, all over him. I was waiting for him to blow up on Nan, but he bottled it all up, obviously trying to make a good impression on his date. She seemed like a perfectly lovely lady. I told Nan to make sure everything was good for her and terrible for Evan. She poured ice water on his lap. She smacked the back of his head with the edge of a tray, spilled soup on his shirt, dropped every fork he asked for. I personally oversalted his food, used the crap liquor for his drinks, used flour instead of sugar on his dessert. To be honest, I don't know why he didn't just walk out. He must have really wanted to frick this woman. Finally, he cracked, demanded Nan find the manager and bring her out. I was only too happy to emerge from the kitchen with my chef's coat and say what I'm not ashamed to admit I'd been planning out all night. I would have said hi earlier, but I didn't want the earthquake to disturb your dinner. I will savor the look on Evan's face for the rest of my life. He was a little too flummoxed to explain, so I pulled a chair up to the table and introduced myself to his date, Amanda. Told her how I met Evan, showed her some of the fun old messages. Then I gave her a voucher for a free meal on her next visit and told Evan to get the frick out and never come back. He deleted his Tinder profile. That last story reminded me of something that happened to me a while back. In addition to this channel, I actually draw cartoons, lots of which are furry stuff. I guess some people have seen my other icons and whatnot, but I do an online comic. It's on commission, so I get paid to do it. It's a story that's been pre-written. I turn it into a comic, post it, all fun stuff. But there's this one guy who is a super fan, I guess, and didn't like the adaptation to comic. So he started commenting negative stuff about every single page, or nearly every single page that got uploaded. And it got me down, and I told the story writer that I didn't want to do it anymore. I thought I might just want to quit, and that for him was the last straw. So he blocked the guy from being able to make comments, because it was just him at the time that was uploading the pictures, or that I was uploading the comics. And so he's like, yeah, you know, I'd rather have you continue making this comic than have this guy being allowed to comment. So that's what happened. He blocked him. The guy went nuts, and I think even to this day he might still be posting stuff, but he would post things on like bad comic review sites and whatnot, just trying to get people to dogpile on us and tell us how crappy our comic is. Who cares? People like it, people don't like it. Not everyone has to like it, that's alright. But he made a blog post about me, and it was funny because he was attacking my appearance and my weight and stuff. And I had anonymous asks on my Tumblr, which I don't think I have anymore. My Tumblr, I think I might have deleted it, I'm not sure. But it was obvious it was him, and he was making comments like that Evan guy and his friends. And I guess he thought it would make me feel really bad, but like it had no effect on me whatsoever. I actually kind of think it's funny. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to link in the description below a post I made in retaliation to his blog post, like kind of going over it step by step, because I still think it's kind of freaking hilarious. And I don't know, you guys might think so too. So that'll be out there for the world to see. And keep in mind, I barely ever think about this guy anymore, but all of this stuff happened in 2012. And occasionally I'll still see stuff about him pop up, and it's kind of really funny. But anyway, enough rambling from me. Bye-bye.
Thanks for listening, everyone, and have a great day.